I am here as the commander of the Lord's army. Suddenly, Joshua realized that this was no ordinary soldier. This was the Lord himself. Joshua fell at his feet in worship. Whose side are you on? The memory verse is from John chapter 14, verse 1. It says, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God, trust also in me." Today's message is we can worship our awesome God every day. Have you ever had part in a program? I mean a really big program in a church with hundreds of seats. You feel important practicing for the program. You mustn't make any mistakes. But then you worry so much that you nearly forget your part. That is about how Joshua felt after Moses died. Joshua walked between the rows of tents. He smiled at the families he passed, but he didn't stop to talk. He needed some exercise. He needed time alone to think. So many amazing things had happened in the past few days. Joshua quickly reached the edge of the camp. His steps got even longer as he headed back across the fields. He walked on until he had a good view of the Jordan River. Then he stopped and just looked. The river was flooded and dangerous, but the Israelites were all safely across and in the Promised Land. Once again, their awesome God had seen them through. The people had just finished celebrating the Passover. Soon it would be time to move on. But moving on was scary. The Israelites had powerful enemies in this new land. As Joshua slowly turned in a circle, he studied the great walled city of Jericho. Big, tall walls. Thick walls. How small the Israelite camp looked with Jericho's walls towering above them. Joshua had no idea what to do. How was he going to lead the army of Israel against that mighty city? They had no fancy weapons of war. Joshua shuddered to think of his poorly trained soldiers. They were not ready for battle. Suddenly, someone stood in front of Joshua holding a sword. Joshua stepped boldly up to him. "Whose side are you on?" Joshua asked. "Ours or our enemies?" If he were an Israelite soldier, he had some explaining to do. Joshua had not told any of his soldiers to leave camp. If the stranger were an enemy, Joshua was ready to fight. "Neither," the man answered. "I am here as the commander of the Lord's army." Suddenly, Joshua realized that this was no ordinary soldier. This was the Lord himself. Joshua fell at his feet in worship. "I am your servant, sir. What do you want me to do?"
"Take your sandals off. You are standing on holy ground," the commander replied.
Joshua removed his sandals and worshiped the Lord. What a relief! Joshua had been thinking about battle plans. He had imagined there was to be a war and that he would be the general in charge. But now he learned that the battle was the Lord's. The plans were already made, and the Lord was in charge. Joshua did not have to bear the heavy responsibility of leadership all alone. The Lord was here. His awesome God was with him. Escape from Jericho. The message is with our church family, we listen and learn what is important. Our memory verse this week is from Matthew chapter 6, verse 33. It says, "Seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well." Natasha sat under a table that was covered with blankets. She typed on an old typewriter hidden inside a wooden box. The blankets and the box helped soften the sound of the typewriter so it could not be heard outside. Why was she doing that? She lived in a country where books about Jesus were forbidden. But books about Jesus were important to Natasha and other Christians. So Natasha risked her life to type copies of these books so others could learn more about Jesus. One day, the police pounded on Natasha's door. They arrested her and took her away. A long time ago, the guards in Jericho wanted to arrest two men who were working for God. This is how it happened. 40 years went by after the 10 spies brought back their discouraging report. Joshua, the young spy who joined Caleb in bringing a good report about the Promised Land, was now Israel's leader, and he was still looking for ways to encourage people. Just as Moses had done years before, Joshua sent out spies. This time, the two spies went into the Promised Land. "Go, look over the land," Joshua told them, "especially Jericho." So the men slipped into that mighty city. That night, they went to a house built on the city wall. Rahab, the woman who lived there, answered their knock. She knew they were Israelites, yet she invited them inside. Now everyone in Jericho, including Rahab, knew about the Israelites. Everyone knew the Lord fought Israel's battles, and that scared the king of Jericho and his army. But instead of calling the soldiers, Rahab talked to the men. Then she hid the two Israelites on her roof under some stalks of flax. When the king's soldiers came knocking, Rahab swung the door wide open.
"Bring the men who have come to spy on us," they demanded.
"The men left here a short time ago," she lied. "Go quickly and you will surely catch them."
The soldiers dashed away looking for the spies. About that same time, the gates of Jericho clanked shut. The city settled down to sleep. When all was quiet, Rahab crept onto the roof.
"I know the Lord has given the land to your people," she told the spies. "We have heard how he dried up the Red Sea for you. Everyone is afraid. Our courage has melted. You know I have shown kindness to you. Give me a sign that you will show kindness to my family."
"We will," the men promised.
"Our lives for your lives. You don't tell what we are doing, and you will be safe when the Lord gives us the land."
So Rahab took a red rope to let the spies down from her window.
"After we have gone, tie this rope in your window," the spies told her. "When we take the city, we will save you and the family members inside the house with you, but the rope must be in the window."
Rahab watched as the men climbed down the rope and disappeared into the darkness. She carefully tied the cord to the window. Deep in her heart, she knew that she had discovered something very important. The God of Israel was the true God. He would be her God from that day on. Crossing the Runaway River. The message is God gives us leaders to help us do great things for Him. Our memory verse this week is Joshua chapter 3, verse 5. The Lord will do amazing things among you. How do you feel when you wake up on a day when you know something exciting is going to happen? What if it's something you've never done before? Let's imagine how an Israelite boy may have experienced a very exciting day. Sunlight streamed through the tent flap, waking Heber. He stretched lazily for a moment before he remembered. Joshua said today was the day. Today the Lord would do something amazing.
What would it be? Heber wondered. God had done amazing things for the Israelites. He'd heard hundreds of times about how God had parted the Red Sea and led the people out of Egypt. He had eaten manna every day of his life. It was amazing. Food every day without fail. And then, not long ago, an Israelite army had defeated those two kings, Sihon and Og. Yes, God had done some amazing things, Heber decided. But those things had all happened when Moses had been leading. Moses was dead now, and Joshua was their new leader. Was Joshua as good a leader as Moses? Heber wondered. Would God still do amazing things for the Israelites? Heber got up and stepped outside. It had rained a lot lately, and the days were getting warmer. The melting snow in the mountains raced toward the river. The Jordan River was a muddy, angry torrent high over its banks. Canaan, the Promised Land, was on the other side of it, and they had been camped here for 3 days. His thoughts were interrupted by his father's urgent voice.
Joshua is giving instructions, he said. Come quickly.
Joshua was already speaking when Heber and his father arrived.
The Ark of the Covenant will go into the Jordan ahead of you, he was saying. You are to move out from your positions and follow it. As soon as the priests who carry the Ark of the Lord set foot in the Jordan, its waters flowing downstream will be cut off and stand up like a wall. The priests will remain in the middle of the river while the entire Israelite camp crosses. So break camp now and get ready.
We have no time to waste, Heber's father said.
Heber gulped down some manna as he helped to pack. They soon heard the order to line up. Up ahead, he could see the priests carrying the Ark of the Covenant. Moving forward, they were leading the entire Israelite camp straight towards the rushing, roaring river. The priests didn't hesitate for a moment as they stepped right into the rapids. As soon as their feet touched the water, it stopped. The water came to a complete halt, piling up just as Joshua had said it would. The water downstream of the priests kept flowing away from them. In a matter of seconds, the water had disappeared around a bend. The priests moved to the middle of the river. A great shout went up from the Israelites.
Yay!
The line of people moved quickly to the riverbank. They began to pick their way across the rocky riverbed and up the other side. Heber couldn't take his eyes off the priests. His own family moved across the riverbed, over and around rocks. They tried to avoid the little puddles the river left behind. The priest still stood in the middle of the riverbed, still holding the ark high. The next thing Heber knew, he was scrambling up the bank into Canaan. Then he turned to watch while the last of the Israelites stepped into the Promised Land. Finally, the priests crossed. The instant the last priest cleared the banks, the waters broke loose. With a fearsome thunder, they resumed their mighty journey. It was over. As easily as that, their long journey was over. Heber sat down on the riverbank. He looked up at the fluffy clouds overhead. There's no doubt, he thought. God is with Joshua, just as he was with Moses. And I believe even more amazing things are still to come. The Silent Battle. The message is, in God's family, we all work together. Our memory verse this week is from Psalm 133, verse 1. How good and pleasant it is when brothers live together in unity. Did you ever feel so excited you couldn't sleep?
Or have you ever woken up extra early on an extra special day? That's how it may have been the day that the army of Israel marched for the first time around Jericho. Long before daybreak, the Israelite soldiers and priests arose. After a hurried breakfast, the soldiers dressed for battle. Soon they lined up behind the golden Ark of the Covenant. Four priests in spotless white robes stood ready to lift the poles of the Ark to their shoulders. When Joshua, the leader of Israel, appeared, he encouraged all the people. "Do not give a war cry," Joshua directed. "Do not raise your voices. Do not say a word until the day I tell you to shout." A war cry always helped the soldiers feel brave, and it scared the enemy. But Joshua wanted the soldiers to rely only on God. Soon the long parade marched away. A small group of armed soldiers led the way. Behind them came seven priests blowing ram horns trumpets. Then four more priests carrying the Ark of the Covenant. The rest of the army followed. As the Israelites approached Jericho, they saw that the city gates were tightly closed. Soldiers lined the top of the city walls. Their weapons were ready. But before reaching the walls, the Israelites turned and began marching around the city. When the priests rested their trumpets for a few minutes, the only sound was the tramp of hundreds of feet. The Israelite parade marched all the way around Jericho. Then they headed back to camp. The soldiers on the walls lowered their weapons, completely puzzled. What was going on? The next day, the same parade left the Israelite camp and marched toward Jericho. First, soldiers. Then, seven priests playing trumpets. Next, priests carrying the Ark. And finally, more soldiers. Trumpets blared. The soldiers marched. No one said a word. Each soldier knew that he was helping just by marching and not saying a word. Again, the parade circled the city. Again, they marched back to camp, leaving the people in Jericho bewildered. What kind of war was this? The same parade wound its way around Jericho the third day, and the fourth day, and the fifth day, and the sixth day. The people locked in the city could hardly stand it. At sunrise on the seventh day, the long parade of soldiers and priests formed once more. They left the Israelite camp and moved toward Jericho. The walls of the great city again lined with soldiers. The parade circled the city once more. But it did not return to camp as it had before. Instead, the soldiers and priests took a second turn around the city. Then they marched it around a third time. Then the Israelite army marched all the way around Jericho four times, five times, six times, seven times. Then the parade stopped. The priests put the trumpets to their lips and sounded a mighty blast. "Shout!" Joshua commanded. "The Lord has given you the city." The soldiers threw back their heads and shouted with all their might, "Yah!" That's when the completely unexpected happened. The absolutely, positively impossible happened. With a deafening rumble, the walls of Jericho gave way and fell down. The Israelites rushed into Jericho and took the city. God had given Jericho into Israel's hands. The victory was God's, but the Israelites had played their part. They had worked together, as Joshua instructed.
This podcast is read by Frenita Buddy for Gracelink.net. Created and produced by Falvo Fowler. Post-produced by Faith Toe at Studio Elpizo. The theme music is by Clayton Kinney. Animation and artwork by Diogo Godoy. The audio engineer was Karel Holness. For more information, please visit gracelink.net.